Det gör vi tid på.
Hello art family, and thank you to new subscribers. For this video, I wanted to cover a topic that comes up in workshops I've taught, which is people transitioning from just sketching the local color they see to trying to actually apply the laws of light that they're experiencing. If you just want to skip to the demo, it's at 3 minutes and 33. One of the homework assignments I usually assign, especially on the first day, is to go on a walk, observe the light that you see, and try to find a white house in your neighborhood or wherever you can. One of the biggest jolts forward I have in sketching was to sketch a white house, which wasn't intentional. I just happened to be sketching a white house, and I noticed it was just a total symphony of all different kinds of colors and things that ways that the light was affecting it. It's a great way to get rid of worrying about the local color and just focus on the laws of light. So let's take a look at those. The first thing you'll observe is that we have two main light sources. A warm light from the sun that's coming down directly, if it's direct light. Now if there's clouds, it's going to be diffused and shot everywhere. But usually, with direct light, we're dealing with a warm light directly on the object and a blue light of the atmosphere and sky coming from the other direction that's going to light up all the shadow side. The warm light's going to bounce off the ground and up into all the bottom facing or downward facing planes. And the blue light of the atmosphere is going to light up all the shadow sides. Next, we'll consider all the local colors, like the green of the trees. They're going to get warmer as they face the sunlight and duller as they face away. Objects in the background are going to be a lot lighter. A lot of the atmosphere that's in the air is going to be blocking it, so it's going to become a lot lighter and a lot duller. So objects in the foreground need to have a lot more saturation to make them look like they're coming forward. This can be achieved by adding white or water if it's watercolor, and also using complementary colors. You'll notice for this, I added little speckles of red in the green. I also do the same with shadows with blues. I add little specks of burnt sienna. Their proximity creates an optical gray. Next, if we're talking about grass, light is going to bounce off of the grass and up into the bottom areas of the object. So you have light that bounces off of the ground and up into things, so you'll get a greener tone towards the bottom of things. Next, we have shadows. Note that they're bluer as they get further away and they have more atmospheric light, and they have burnt sienna and a kind of warm color towards the object to give a contrast to the shadow and color. It's also a great opportunity for overlap or foreground elements. Look for cloud shadows and things outside of the picture frame that would cast softer shadows to also expand the visual experience. Be careful to observe the windows. More often than not, it's actually a warm color on the inside and not a cool color. People typically go with blue, but it's usually warm. And lastly, definitely the biggest mistake I have students make is the underfacing planes of siding and things. Always make sure it's warm and soft. That's a lot of times people will go dark with blue, and you lose a lot of the visual experience if you go way too dark on the bottom of siding and objects. Okay, so now for a demonstration of a white house. I'm working on a sheet of 140-pound cold-pressed arches that's been taped to a sketchbook. Since it's not about the sky, I try to get in the sky relatively quickly by suggesting it. I get a big wet pool and I dance around and skip around, leaving some blank white areas, and I wet the whole sky area, and then I drop in some cobalt blue with a little bit of red mixed in it, and then I also add yellow ochre to the bottom of the sky, because this is an evening sketch, so the sun was going down and it was getting really, really warm across the bottom of the sky. Pre-wetting will make it so that those colors will melt together really well. To get a very soft edge on the very distant trees, I started to sort of suggest them and indicate them with a green, with a lot of blue and some red in that. And then I'm going to start putting in the grass to just chisel out the form of the house that I'm looking at. I'm adding a little bit of red, and I also want to make sure that I'm increasing the saturation and increasing the strength as it gets closer. The house I'm looking at has a forest next to it, so it's casting a really big shadow across the front of the yard, which is nice. It's a good thing to observe things that cast a big shadow across the front of a sketch, or sometimes just make it up and add a little bit of a shadow across the front of a sketch. It helps to draw the viewer into the picture space. So here we go, one of our first things we talked about. I'm finding all of the underfacing planes that are pointing downwards, and I'm adding yellow ochre, a little bit of raw sienna, just to warm them up so that whatever I do with them later, they'll have a kind of glow to them. A lot of times for my cartooning work or comic book work, I will increase that yellow ochre to make it have a kind of glow to it. One of the things students also struggle with is, how do you get the sketch down when the light changes so much in just 20 minutes? It's a completely different sketch every 20 minutes. And one of the things I like to do is just get a value sketch down as a kind of underpainting. So I'm putting in this blue for the atmosphere. I'm getting in the shadows of what I'm looking at. The sun was about to go down, so it's about to all go blue in just a moment as that tree forest shadow overtakes the whole house. So I want to get down the information I'm seeing, and then I can kind of work with the laws of light that I know. I'm starting to put in the bushes, and I'll look at some of the trees around the house, and I want to make sure to increase that saturation. You can already see how increasing the saturation of that green already makes those shrubs pop forward a lot more than those blue trees in the very far distance. Now that I have the kind of value guide to the image I'm looking at, I'm trying to be as bold and direct with the color as I can be. That's just something you can't really fake with watercolor. You sort of have to just do it and ruin a whole lot of sketches to get to a place where you're comfortable just scooping up a big hunk of paint and smearing it around and fixing it or throwing the sketch away. But it's important to making a successful watercolor or gouache sketch. I find I say this a lot in my videos, but you really have to learn to abandon the attachment to the image in order to make good images. So I'm noting that the house has one side that's getting hit directly with the light and it's super bright. And then the other side is gonna be dulled down, but it's also picking up the warm greens off the ground and the warm yellow lights that are being bounced up into the house. So I keep those mixtures in mind as I get a sort of dull gray, green, yellow, and knock out the sides of the house that are not completely in shadow. I'm trying to go ahead and deal with the local color of the roof. The side that's not getting hit as much, I'm trying to cool down as it gets some atmospheric light, and then I'm trying to warm up the other side. I try to do that with everything I observe. A little bit of warm, a little bit of cool. Always be sort of dancing between the two, sort of softly transitioning between warm and cool and warm and cool. The impulse with windows, I think, for a lot of people is that, well, there's blue sky, so they're probably going to be blue, but I'm noting in my observation that the windows I see are warm. They're distinctly warm. For my drawing of this house, I left out a lot of things like the deck, and for the shrubs, I just put a sort of circle. A lot of those things I don't draw with a pencil because I don't want to get too wrapped up in the detail. I want to make sure I'm focusing all of my detail and color contrast on the area of interest. And all of those areas, they can kind of fade away. In fact, a lot of times I just sort of wet the area up and let them just sort of fade away into softness. Now that I have the larger masses and shapes in, and have even put the detail of the shutters in, I'm going to start trying to look around for the coping and the gutters and the soffit vents, any of the smaller downward facing planes that I can add some warmth to. I'm going to start putting in the shadow under the shrubberies, and I'm noticing that the drawing's a little off on those. They're a little bit too low, so I'm going to try to correct that and smear that in. If I can't fix it, I'll come back with gouache. It's no problem. One of the things I begin to notice is that the grass has all dried very light and it's all kind of the same tone. So I want to increase the saturation as it gets closer to me. And here I want to put in just a suggestion, just a light suggestion, not on the directly exposed side, but on the side facing slightly away of the shadow side of the underside of the siding. So I'm using a yellow ochre, and then it gets greener as it gets lower to the ground as light bounces off the grass and carries that green light into the bottom facing planes that are lower. Always try to observe reflected light, that is light that bounces off an object and shoots its local color into another object nearby. But remember that that light does not carry very far. So light hits an object and is greatly, greatly reduced in strength and then bounces off into other objects. I've kind of been able to develop a quick sense of getting the shapes in 3D space of houses specifically and the perspective using the paint to draw it, because I've done a lot of these sketches like this, plein air sketches, because on a side gig sometimes in between comics work or illustration work I'll do house plein air sketches for real estate agents. So it's kind of a nice side gig if you're looking for some extra scratch to try to make friends with a local real estate agent and get really good and fast at sketching. So here's a trial and error mistake I made. I made the shadow of the bushes way too low. So you can see I'm trying to draw it in and then wet the area and use my paper towel. And that doesn't work because it's too dark and it's dried, so now that's there. So I'm going to have to try to figure out a way to lighten that area back up and sort of hide the mistake I made. So I'm using white gouache mixed with some of the color of the grass so that it has body and I can add some form back in. I've heard some people kind of scoff who use watercolor at using gouache on top of watercolor, but I don't know. Back when we used to live in Virginia, there was a museum, the Virginia Museum of Fine Arts, and they had a couple Sargent and a couple Winslow Homer watercolors, and they had gouache on top of them. So my opinion is if it was good enough for the kings of watercolor, then it's good enough for me. I'm coming back with a stronger shadow because I thought it'd be a good opportunity to kind of pull the shadow, rake it across the hill of the yard to give form to the yard so you get a sense that it's kind of a rolling hill. And now I'm doing one of those things I talked about where I've put the sketch down but I'm noticing all of the distant trees and things all have hard edges, and I don't want hard edges on anything except for the object of interest. So if it's a portrait of a person or if it's a house or a boat, I'm always careful to try to keep all the hard edges on just the object of interest and then to just soften and smear and push away. It gives a nice effect of atmosphere and it really draws a viewer in, gives scope, kind of telescopes the image. So once again, I'm going to use that white gouache to add body to a green and correct this mistake I made in the drawing with the paint. So that's going to do it for this demonstration. I hope you got a lot out of it, learned a lot out of it. If you have any questions, feel free to ask me in the comments or contact me on social media. And I encourage you to get out there and take a walk and try to find yourself a white house that you can observe and sketch. Sketch in the morning, sketch at night, sketch in direct light, sketch in diffuse light. I'd love to hear about your experience with it. Oh, also, and thank you to everyone who bought a copy of the Fraggle Rock book that I did that just came out. I appreciate all the kind words and the support. So, thank you all, and happy sketching!